to some extent. A bit of the work of Kerala school will also come tomorrow, that talk of groups. So in this talk, there will be very few groups, though Kerala school is known for that. So some of the results can illustrate. The rest you can read from the available materials. Development of calculus is to be covered. I will start from older period, that how ideas of calculus were there. So roughly the material is in that whatever article Ram Subramanian I have written in that volume edited. Roughly that is the material. You have already read it on the MES. So in the earlier period, what are all the kind of ideas which indicate this progress towards calculus? So one is the idea, concept of zero and infinity. And the idea of infinity is fairly old, as Ram Subramanian showed to you, that Shanti Mantra of Ishopanishad, where if an infinite amount is taken out of another infinite amount, infinite remains. Of course, the word being used is purna or complete. But then, later algebra people are using it as an instance of the concept of infinity. So, Bhaskaracharya, in his Bijagarita, is using this. We will come to that. Let's go through. We will come back to the meaning of the Shanti Mantra later. So, as far as zero is concerned, Panini has this idea of zero morphing, which I explained to you. There is this very profound idea of abhava in Nyaya. So, when we merely talk of absence, it appears as if it's nothing. But, so Nyaya will say, now I have kept this marker here. I have taken out this marker here, so there is an abhava of the marker. There may not be abhava of something else there. So, each abhava will be abhava of something. Then they will go forward, they will say, this is not present here by a particular relation. So, an abhava of something through a particular relation. That is what is an abhava. Now, this is used in a very deep way in Nayayika logic later to do what is called quantification, which is done in modern logic in a different, very profound manner. Now, the shunya is used as a symbol in Chandra Sutra. Whether they had the idea of zero as a number is not known. Of course, by the time of Brahmagupta, it appears the mathematics of zero is fully established, except Brahmagupta has a slight, from the modern point of view, division by zero. He just calls it as tacheda. And some later scholars implied to mean A divided by zero to be zero itself. So as I told you, one physical way of trying to explain it, how that confusion could have arisen, but that's not very important. By the time of Bhaskara, this idea of some quantity divided by zero is really very, very large, and it is what traditionally could have been called as ananta or infinite, is fairly standard. So in Bhaskara's algebra, bharo bhave kena bhaktascha rashi, so a number divided by zero will be called kahara. I am anantaha rashi, 3 by 0, kahara if you chate. Having said that, he uses this verse. Asmin nikaraha kaharena rashau abhi pravishteshvabhi nisruteshu bahushvabhisya layashkrishnikale anantye achyute bhutakaneshu yadvat. This has a meaning very similar to purnamadaha, purnamida, purnam, purnamudachyate. So it is a very similar thing that at the time of creation, even though an huge or unmeasurable amount of entities have emanated from the Ananta Achyuta, and again it goes back, there is no change in that Ananta Achyuta. So this is sort of use of those philosophical ideas in understanding. Now, Bhaskara goes and does more attempts to handle this division by zero in a manner analogous to what we would do today. And In these examples, you can see the extent to which he is successful and the extent to which he is not successful in handling this. So here this example, he basically says, whenever you are doing a calculation where multiplications and divisions of zero appear, you keep that zero there. Don't do the calculation. In the end, cross it off. This is the kind of thing he says. And he says that way you will always get correct results. So, avikrita eva jneha tathaiva keno nitashta yuta. So, whenever the multiplier becomes zero, and whenever there is a divisor zero, then you just keep them as they are without doing anything, and in the end, you will be able to do it. And he says, asya ganitasya grahaganite mahan upyoga. This kind of calculation will have great application in astronomy. So he is thinking of this kind of situations occurring in astronomy. So now here's one problem. Better, instead of going to Sanskrit, we will write what the problem he is saying, because you can later on read it, and the translation is there in the material supplied to you. Time is short. So x plus x by 2 into 3 by 0, whole thing multiplied by 0 is equal to 63. This is the equation Bhaskara is wanting to solve. And then he cancels out the 0 and obtains the solution x is equal to 40. He has some very vague idea of limit, but he does not have the idea of different orders of zero or different orders of infinity, meaning different ways in which a quantity is tending to zero, different ways in which a quantity is tending to infinity. He is perhaps not able to separate. That is what becomes clear in this second example. This is an example in Hilal. This example is in Bijagita. The example is x plus x root 2 into 0 whole thing square plus 2 into x plus x root 2 multiplied by 0 whole thing divided by 0 is 15. So here in one term 0 squared is appearing, another thing 0 is appearing, and then division by 0 is appearing, and Bhaskara is just cancelling them out, both the things. So if we think of this, that he has an idea of limit, here he does not have an idea of limit, at least he still is grappling with it. So, kaha swartha sahita x plus x by 2 rashi khaguno multiplied by 0 vargito, it is squared and it is added yutaha swapadabhya, it is added by the square root of that same thing ka bhaktashta, that is also multiplied by 0 and jataha panchadasha uchyatam, so divided by 0, you get 15. So Bhaskara just crosses out the zeros and obtains x is equal to. This is, of course, a ill-posed problem in the way we will think of it today. Even by limits, we cannot sort out. And otherwise, it will become infinite. Now we go to another set of ideas which are basic for calculus to develop. This is trying to have a being able to grapple with real numbers, trying to go beyond rationals and understand irrationals. Now, so irrationals are dealt with through approximation. There is no fear of irrational quantities. It is known that they are not accessible as ratios of numbers, or at least that we do not have expressions for them as ratios of integers. But we can approximate them and handle them. This is the way we go. So it goes back to Shuddha Sutras, which give this approximation for square root of 2 and pi, which we have discussed. And Arya Bhatia gives for the first time the square rooting process as a systematic sequential algorithm, that for numbers which do not have square root, this method can still be used to find better and better approximation per square root. Is implicit in Arya Bhatia and in Bhaskara's commentary, but a very clear exposition is there in Sridhara's Trishatika. Very simple. You want to take the square root of pi, or 55, let us say. You can only go one step by the Arya Bhatia rule, you only get 7. So how to go further? Multiply this quantity by 10,000. Do the square root of this, divide it by 100, which is the square root of 10,000. Then you get the a rational expression, ratio of two integers, which is a better approximation to root 55 than just 7. Instead of 10,000, you could have multiplied it by 10 to the power 12, divided it by 10 to the power 6 after the root calculation is given. That is the process Sridhara is explaining. So they didn't have decimal numbers, but they had a very clear way of going further and further and calculating better and better approximation to square roots. And they also knew that this process is unending. So this much was all very clear. Now, Narayan Pandita, of course.
In practice, did they always multiply by powers of 10?
That also, I think Sridhara is giving that sort of powers of 10.
Always powers of
10. I think so, because I'll check it. The example I know of is powers of 10.
Multiplying by powers of 10 is same as...
No, nothing is same as another thing. Once you have decimals, you can use it in many different ways. Yeah. Just the notation, sign is very different from power. It is same.
Conceptually, it would still be different, but the same function and value.
Yes.
That's what I'm saying.
Approximation for that, it's all. But decimal lets you move in some direction. Like the sign is similar, it's just off the card, but it lets you move in an entirely different direction. Okay. Decimal system was in around 12th century, done in West Asia, Samwal and various other. Even Al-Euclid is itself a 10th century book, which is discussing Indian mathematics, has basic idea of decimal system. If you can have positive powers of 10, why not have 1 by 10? The Babylonians had a decimal kind of thing with a sexagesimal place value. So they were moving between 60, 60 squared, 60 cubed, and coming down. Now, we also did it, but that was in terms of physical quantities. Like you have hour, then minute, then second, then the next unit, whatever it is called, the farads. Like that you can go. And that is like working with
that. That probably came from the Greeks.
That could be. But what I'm saying is that way of working was clear in all physical problems. Equivalent of decimal, working with decimals, here in sexagesimals, mostly in astronomy, was very common. Now, Narayan Pandita, this example I showed you yesterday, he uses square root of 10, he uses the bhavana, obtains the first order solution. Then, by doing bhavana, you get better and better rational approximation for square root of 10. And this approximate value for pi is also there, that you can go make better and better approximation. This Yukti Bhasha gives a method, which is similar to the method originated by Archimedes. He used a hexagon, Yukti Bhasha uses a square. Archimedes used an inscribed and a circumscribed hexagon. And then doubled the side to a 12-sided polynomial, then 24-sided polynomial. So the perimeter of that hexagon approximates the perimeter of the circle, is the idea. So here you start with a square, then go to an octagon, then a 16-sided figure. Estimate the perimeter by geometry, and that gives better and better approximation to the circumference in terms of the radius. So handling irrational by iterative approximation is very, very natural. It is coming from Chula Sutra. Now there is this thing, the second order sign difference formula of Aryabhata. This will be discussed later in some detail in your talk. Or when we come to it later, we can also discuss it. This is the geometric series. We know it has been summed by Pingala in the Chandra Sutra. He gave that formula. Mahaviracharya gives this sum of geometric series in the mathematics book for the first time. Geometric series is not dealt with in Brahmasputta Siddhanta. This is given by Pratulaka Swami in his commentary, the same sum. Pratulaka Swami, Mahaviracharya, roughly of the same time, 850 AD. Now, Veerasena, in his commentary Dhavara, this is dated 860, has given the sum of an infinite geometric series, and this is used in trying to find the volume of a frustum of a right circular cone. This text needs to be further analyzed. This proof of this in Shankara Raman is outlined in Saraswati Amma's book, which you will find in your books, but it needs to be further studied. Now, another very important idea associated with the development of calculus in the idea of instantaneous velocity. So that the velocity is changing, and so you need to have a better and better approximation for velocity is there in Bhaskara 1 itself. So he is using essentially the correction to the motion of a planet comes from a sine function. So sine of some alpha t is coming, let's say. That's how the position of the planet, the longitude is a function of time. Then you need to differentiate it. So you use the sine difference tables and try to find out how much it has changed. And Bhaskaran knew that is not really a good way you have to have. And for the first time, the cosine function as a derivative of sine function to give the what is called this Putta Mandagati is found in Munjala's Raghumanasa. Around the same time, there is a later Rajabhata who has written a work called Mahasiddhanta. There is a chapter on Ganita in that. And there also, it's in the astronomy part, the velocity of a planet is computed in terms of the cosine function. Now, Bhaskara discusses this much more clearly in his, because he is writing a commentary in Siddhanta Shiromani. So he explains in the context of the moon. Tatkalikaya Bhutya Chandrasya Vishtam Prayodhanam, because within the same day, earlier in astronomy you are just calculating the position of the planet today in the morning, sunrise, the position of the planet tomorrow in the morning at sunrise. Then you have what is called the Dainandina Bhukti, the amount traversed by in a day. So that was good enough for calculating. But for moon, since it traverses about 12-13 degrees every day, you need a formula for every hour or every 2 hours, and even for half an hour. So, yataha chandragati mahatvat pratikshanam samana bhavati. In every second, the velocity of moon is different, every instant of it, the pratikshanam. Ataha tadartham, I am visheshaha abhiyata, so that this using of this cosine is just explaining it, that it is, there is like every instant, the rate of change of motion is different. That is a very clear statement of the idea that the position of the moon is also changing every instant of time. So is the speed of the moon as well. Now finally, it is in the calculation of surface area and volume of a sphere, and similarly cylinder, cone, etc., that the ideas of calculus become necessary. They were first calculated in the Greek tradition by Archimedes, who used this geometric series also, and who used basically, he did not calculate limits of series. He wrote down expression and then proved that what we now know as the limit of the series, if you assume that the value becomes larger than that limit, you will get a contradiction. If you assume that it becomes much smaller than that limit, you will get a contradiction. Therefore, ultimately, it should reach that value. So that was the kind of reductio ad absurdum argument Archimedes used to prove. In fact, he valued the work that he wrote on the volume and the area of a sphere and enclosing it in a cylinder so much that he had insisted that it should be put on his grave. The grave of Archimedes, which people had forgotten for about 1,200 years, was later on in Syracuse, was later on located by these symbols of the circle. Meaning, this is a very highly valued problem. Now, in India, we know that Aryabhatta had the correct understanding that the volume of a sphere is proportional to R cube, but he did not come up with the correct formula. Not only the correct factor, but the correct relation between the surface area and the volume. I mean, the pi is approximate, not well known, is not the issue. There are two things to pi. If you go to a circle, there is the area of the circle which is pi r squared, and the circumference of the circle which is 2 pi r. So Euclid proves both the theorems, but he does not know the constant which arises, one is the same as the constant which arises in the other. It's Archimedes who shows that, whereas in the case of a circle, the triangulation argument gives you straight away the relation between the circumference and the area. But that kind of a proof is not Euclidean. You remember the proof that Professor Sriram gave. It's a standard kind of proof in employed in Indian mathematics. You have a circle. To think of this as being made up of triangles, make this triangle smaller and smaller and apply the formula. So the radius itself will be the perpendicular there of R times delta S. And then sum it over all the delta S. So that is 2 pi R. So the relation between the circumference and the area can be obtained by this argument. But such an argument would be unacceptable in the Euclidean approach. Archimedes did the same kind of an argument, but he would use this polygon inscribed and circumscribed and use a Dirichlet algorithm. Indians will use an infinite series and try to show that it goes to that value. This is the different place in which we do. So in the Vasana commentary, Bhaskara, for the first time, gives a detailed argument for the surface area of a sphere, volume of a sphere. Volume of a sphere can be immediately obtained by doing a similar argument by using pyramids. A sphere being enclosed by pyramids, you know the volume of this pyramid is 1/3 area of the base into height. Then you will immediately get the relation between the volume of the sphere and the surface area of the sphere. But to get the surface area of the sphere, Bhaskara had to really do a summation over area substrips. And now the area substrips he could calculate using the sine table. And then he said, you usually the sine table, as Ramasubramanian will later explain to you, you take 90 degrees, divide it into 24 parts, and write down the sine values. So if you merely sum that sine table, you will not get the exact answer. That is like a numerical integration. So Bhaskara knows this. He says that you can of course do larger number of divisions of the 90 degrees. And so at the last point he said, though it's approximate, he obtained 3.439 or something. He said, we'll assume it to be 3.438, which is the measure of the radius, and wrote down the answer. So he did a numerical integration for the surface area of a sphere. We will not have time to go into this, because we have to explain to you the way later calculus is done. But this is all there in literature, you can see. So this is the kind of background which, there's one more thing. The summation of series, progressions. This is also very basic to the later work in calculus. Arrivederci had this repeated summation. If 1, 2, etc. added up to n is n into n plus 1 by 2. Now these numbers themselves added will give n into n plus 1 into n plus 2 by 6. This is called repeated summation. First order repeated summation. These are called triangular numbers. These are what are pentagonal numbers or whatever. If you add them, you will get the next similar kind of looking expression. And it was Narayan Pandita who sort of said that if you repeat this summation n times, if you keep on summing whatever you get again and again, you get this kind of an expression. And remember that this is exactly the method that Parahamihira is using to calculate the binomial coefficient by that Meru cluster. So in some sense, all this is known, but the exact statement of this relation appears for the first time in Narayan Pandita's Ganita Kaumudi. So let us now go straight away to the Kerala school. Madhava is the Kerala was home of a lot of astronomy and mathematics before the 14th century. It's not that suddenly something started there or whatever. A new wave, of course, did start. So it goes back to, and there are views that Aryabhatta made from Kerala. Haridatta is the originator of a system of astronomy known as the Parahika Ganita. Devacharya has written a Karana text called Karana Ratna. Govinda Swami, he wrote a commentary on Mahavaskariya, and he also improved upon the sign tables of Aryabhatta. Shankar Narayana is a commentator on Laghu Bhaskariya. He was working in an observatory in Kerala in 1960. He talks of this observatory and the king asking him to fix the time of eclipses. Then, Professor Yuvakaran has written a paper on this recently. Then, Uday Yuvakaran, he has commented upon the Raghu Bhaskariya, and it's in this book that you find for the first time mention of Jayadeva's algorithm on Bhagavata. Chakravarti. So Mahadeva is supposed to be, there are two versions of Brahmins in Kerala, Nambudaris. He is called an Embrantari Brahmin. That means he is from this Mangalore kind of area, he said. He is from a place called Sangamagrama. It's about, 30 kilometers from Kochi. What is the name of Iranyalapalli?
Iranyalakuda.
There's a railway station there, somewhere next to it, people say, is the house. There's of course a big temple there. This exact house, still I think, not fully identified, at least I could tell you. Now about Madhava himself, this is the period, roughly 1340 to 1425. He is the teacher of Parameshwara, who we know was around in this period. And only two books and a few small tracts of Madhava are available. Venmaroha and Spottachandratri are both in what is called the Vakya tradition of astronomy, and they deal with computation of the longitude of moon. The speciality is they tell you within a day, for about 7-8 sub-periods, how the exact longitude of the moon can be calculated by a formula. And that is the kind of, it's an ingenious methodology derived from the, using the older theories only, the methodology is ingenious, and that's the kind of thing Madhava will be known for. He is called Golavid, the person who is very well versed in spherical astronomy. And the other words, there is one Mahajanena. Then there is another one on this, what is the one you are published in? The one on the Karana.
Madhyamanena
Prakara. One on this iterated Avishesha Karana. There is a track. So about, these are all published. Some perhaps are still one has to search. Parameshwara is the disciple of Madhava. He has written all these and about a couple of books on astrology also. And Vrigganita is his main thing. He has revised the old parameters and slightly methods of calculation. These are very important commentaries, especially the he has written a commentary on Govinda Swami's commentary on Mahabhaskara. So it's a super commentary. It's called Siddhanta Deepika. It was published in 1957 by Upanna Shastri from Chennai. This commentary on Aryabhatiya is very important. He is describing the geometrical picture of planetary motion as per the Aryabhatian system there. And most unfortunately, even today, this commentary on Lilavati that Professor Sri Ram alluded to is not published. Only occasional results from this are quoted. This Lilavati Vivarana of Parameshwara is not yet published. This famous formula for the circumradius of a cyclic quadrilateral in terms of the site is quoted from that, both by Saraswati Amma, Harshi Gupta. He is supposed to have observed for about 50 years, and perhaps that is what influenced his very famous student, Nilakanta Swamiyaji. Nilakanta Swamiyaji is the student of son of Parameshwara called Damodara, and he of course talks of having met Parameshwara in his childhood, and he is called Paramacharya by Nilakanta Swamiyaji. He is from Tirukandru. This place is identifiable, but his house is not fully identifiable. When this Tantra Sangraha, which was written in 1500, where he has proposed a correction to the, or a revision of the older planetary theory of Aryabhata, and that takes once a day Indian planetary theory into a very, very new direction. Aryabhatiya Bhasha is a very detailed commentary on Aryabhatiya. In the Ganita Pada, he almost writes detailed notes and proofs and explanations and commentary on every verse of Aryabhata. Gola Sara Chandra Chaya Ganita Siddhanta Darpana. These are works on specific aspects of astronomy and general discussion. Jyotirmimamsa is a discussion on how astronomical theories vary with time and how astronomers have to continuously keep observing, keep checking their calculations with respect to the observations and keep revising this theory, and that is the only way in which they can survive in their profession in, with respectively. This is the essence of Jyotirmimamsa. Last put on any Vishaya Pavasana in a very small tract, but it has some wonderful piece of information on the way Nilakanta had understood.